So I wanted to thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Taming the Flame During Inflammation. I'm Sally Cummins, and I'm Vice President of Scientific Affairs and Outreach with National Dairy Council. As you know, inflammation is a hot topic with consumers, the media, and health professionals, as well as nutrition scientists. According to Hartman Research, close to half of those surveyed from Gen Z to boomers are interested in managing inflammation through diet. At National Dairy Council, we're often asked if dairy foods cause inflammation, and what exactly does the science say when it comes to dairy and inflammation? So I'm thrilled to welcome Dr. Brad Bowling and registered dietitian Jim White, who will provide an in-depth look at the state of science on dairy foods and inflammation, as well as provide strategies for keeping inflammation in check. Dr. Bowling is the associate professor of the Fritz Friday Chair for Vegetable Processing Research in the Department of Food Science at the University of Wisconsin at Madison, and he earned his undergraduate and PhD degrees in food science at UW-Madison as well, and received a postdoctoral training in nutrition sciences at the Nutrition Research of Aging at Tufts University. Dr. Bowling's research focus is determining how foods and phytochemicals can best be utilized to prevent chronic diseases, and his current research aims to characterize how bioactives from fermented dairy, fruits, and vegetables inhibit chronic inflammation by modulating immune cells and the gut barrier. The Bowling Research Group is utilizing human intervention studies, cell culture, and animal models of chronic inflammation to accomplish these objectives. Dr. Bowling is a scientific editor for the Journal of Food Science, associate editor of nutrition research, and chair-elect of the International Society for Nutraceuticals and Functional Foods. Dr. Bowling will be joined by Jim White. Jim is a nationally recognized registered dietitian nutritionist, an American College of Sports Medicine exercise physiologist, and owner of two Jim White Fitness and Nutrition Studios, two medical nutrition therapy practices, and Workplace Wellness Corporation. He's been quoted in thousands of publications and featured in hundreds of television and radio segments nationwide, including Today, GQ, Men's Health, USA Today, and The Wall Street Journal. Jim is a past spokesperson of the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics and serves as a National Dairy Council Ambassador. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Bowling.
Great. Thanks, Sally. I'm very happy to be with all of you and to start this conversation on food for health. And my purpose here is to talk about what we know about dairy consumption and inflammation here. So just to begin, I want to point out my disclosures. I've had research funding and honoraria and travel support from the National Dairy Council. And I'd like to think about, for you, you know, what is the perfect meal in your mind? Does this have to do with taste? Does it have to do with health? Is it about family? Is it about occasion? Is it about friendship? What are the things that define a perfect meal for you? And then if we extend that, you know, what is the perfect diet? You know, can we have a perfect dietary pattern here? And when we're thinking about diet in the context of health, we need to turn to the science-based recommendations for diet. And that first comes from the dietary guidelines for Americans. And in the most recent iteration of this, the dietary guidelines defines several different types of healthful dietary patterns. There's a U.S. dietary pattern, there's a Mediterranean dietary pattern, there's a vegetarian dietary pattern, and then the dietary approaches to stop hypertension. And all of these patterns are put together with the aim of reducing chronic disease risk. And this includes heart disease, lowering the risk of heart disease, type 2 diabetes, lowering the risk of cancer, lowering the risk of obesity, for example. Now, the FDA also has a series of science-based health claims about reducing the risk of chronic disease in healthy individuals. These are claims such as reducing sodium intake reduces the risk of hypertension. Increased consumption of fruits, vegetables, whole grain decreases the risk of cancer in healthy individuals, and increased calcium consumption reduces the risk of osteoporosis. These are examples of those types of science-based health claims. Now, underlying chronic disease risk, there's this idea that inflammation is involved in the development and the persistence of many of these chronic diseases. And it's important to point out, as we begin thinking about dairy and inflammation, that there are two kind of distinguishing types of inflammation here. On the left, you can see is this acute inflammatory process. These are a short-term and very, very much necessary types of process to heal wounds, to prevent disease, and that are involved in the normal type of immune response. However, on the right-hand side, we have the illustration of chronic inflammation. And chronic inflammation is, unlike acute, it's long-term, it's low-grade, and this can occur over months to years. And this is the type of inflammation that's associated with chronic disease risk. And some of the hallmarks of chronic inflammation is that it's not easily resolved. It's at typically levels lower than acute. There may not be outward signs or symptoms of inflammation, and it's associated with those chronic diseases. Many diseases have this underlying inflammatory component, such as inflammatory bowel disease, arthritis, cardiovascular disease. And then there are certain risks which may increase or decrease the amount of or extent of chronic inflammation. These are related to obesity, environmental chemical exposure, stress, nutrition, and the microbiome, for example. And when we think about, you know, what we already know about food and inflammation, I just want to point out that we already do know that allergic responses and celiac disease do induce inflammation. And this could be considered a pro-inflammatory food response. And these are typically more severe, acute in the case of an allergic response here. And I just like to point out a small number of individuals do have foods or these allergies to foods or immune responses to foods. And when we talk about dairy and inflammation, we're mainly going to be focusing on healthy individuals that don't have a defined food allergy here. So are there other foods or nutrients that can be pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory? Well, to investigate this using human intervention studies or observational studies, we need to consider what are the sources of inflammation and how we can measure this. Fundamentally, the cells that are involved in the immune response will produce proteins or chemicals that signal that process of inflammation. These are called cytokines or chemokines. These are the principal biomarkers that are used in determining the inflammatory response. So one, we can profile cells and look at their status of inflammation. However, more commonly what's applied is looking at biomarkers such as C-reactive protein, tumor necrosis factor alpha, or other interleukins. And something like CRP would be produced in the liver, and then we'd measure it in the plasma, for example. But there's other tissues. The liver is an important site of these immune cells. But also I'd like to point out that the gut is a very important site of immune function. And if we look closer at the architecture of the gut, you can see that the gut microbiota is separated from the rest of the body by a layer of mucus and the intestinal barrier. So this is an enterocyte barrier that also has goblet cells and other immune cells, such as dendritic cells, that kind of coordinate the immune response to bacteria in the gut. And it turns out that the gut is a very important site, one for a differentiation of immune cells, such as T cells, B cells, and macrophages, also the delivery of antigens and pro-inflammatory molecules, such as endotoxin, across a leaky or compromised barrier there. So the gut can be considered a source of chronic inflammation, kind of underlying the idea that the gut is a very important site of immune function here. And when we think about all of the studies that we can look to inform us about diet and inflammation, we also need to consider the types of studies that we're looking at here. So We like to kind of point this out as tiers of evidence, or this kind of pyramid of evidence, where, you know, we have these kind of foundational studies, which may be something like preclinical studies, so cell-based or rodent type of assays, which can tell us very precisely about a mechanism, but we may not have complete confidence in translating that to human types of studies. So when we get into human studies, we can consider epidemiological or survey-based types of approaches, linking dietary records to medical records or other measurements of biomarkers of inflammation, for example, here, records of disease. And then the gold standard here are randomized controlled trials, where it's a well-controlled study that utilizes an intervention to test a specific hypothesis about food and inflammation. And, you know, when there's multiple interventions and kind of surmounting epidemiological data, we can have these systematic reviews and meta-analyses. So a statistical type of approach to look at the quality of evidence, which increases our confidence in the results there. But, you know, looking at you know, a single dietary component in isolation is somewhat difficult and needs to really be put in the context of other diet and lifestyle factors that may affect immune health. And there's already kind of mounting evidence that dietary factors such as fiber, specific nutrients, other maybe plant-based or animal-based bioactives, probiotics, these can affect immune health. This can affect the gut. This can kind of in turn affect the gut microbiota. And then we also need to put that in context with, you know, what is the population here that we're looking at? What is their health status? Are the individuals, do they have obesity, other chronic diseases? Are they healthy or stressed in other ways? We know things like exercise, smoking, those can potentially affect immune health. And then, you know, what is their baseline kind of intestinal environment look like? And there's a lot of pathways that can be involved in maintaining that immune function, for example, in the gut. So what I would like to do in looking specifically at dairy is to highlight a few epidemiological studies here and kind of point out their results, and then move toward the evidence that we have from intervention studies. So I'm looking at systematic reviews, and then I'd like to just address some of the research from my group investigating yogurt and inflammation. So when we think of, you know, how to link dairy intake to inflammation, we also need to consider that dairy is a category of foods, not a specific food. So when we look at milk, you know, we need to consider all the things that are in milk. So these include vitamins, minerals, but also other bioactive components, which could potentially be beneficial for health, such as whey proteins, polar lipids, for example. And then when milk is cultured into cheese or yogurt, those microorganisms are being added. There may be other probiotics added during the fermentation process. Those may further metabolize components in milks or produce unique metabolites, which are kind of interest in linking the potential health benefits to these particular food items here. So looking at our first epidemiological study, these are results from the REGARDS study, which studied over 14,000 individuals here. And one of the key biomarkers they used in this study was the hsCRP. And they had food records from individuals. And what they did here was hypothesize that there's dietary and inflammatory scores that can be weighted with their relationship toward this inflammatory biomarker. So I'll just kind of point out how this works. Here they hypothesized leafy greens, cruciferous vegetables, tomatoes, apples and berries, yellow or orange vegetables and fruits. These had sufficient amounts of polyphenols, carotenoids, to have a negative weight here, which means they're inversely associated with that inflammatory biomarker. Something like added sugars would increase or have a positive correlation with the inflammatory biomarker. Here in their study, they regarded high-fat dairy and low-fat dairy as a negative correlation because of those bioactive components in dairy. Similarly, they analyzed lifestyle factors such as obesity, exercise, smoking, things like this to kind of compile this diet and lifestyle factors. And what they found here is that both the diet and the lifestyle factors had an association with inflammation there. And each individual factor may have had a modest association in some cases, but really an aggregation of those factors. So really that whole picture of the diet and lifestyle had a much more significant impact on its association with this inflammatory biomarker here. The second study I want to take a look at is the Women's Health Initiative, a report from the Women's Health Initiative study. And here they were focused on postmenopausal women. They had more than 35,000 participants here. And they linked here total dairy, and then they took a look at the individual dairy components as well. Here in this population, they found that total dairy intake was associated with lower CRP levels and IL-6 levels here. So this chart on the top, you can see that for each serving each individual serving of dairy decreased the CRP and IL-6 here. Yogurt, when they began to look at these individual types of foods, had a stronger was associated with a lower instance of biomarker concentration in these individuals here. So another interesting thing is that here, when they look at total dairy and some of these individual dairy components, they did not see an increase in these inflammatory biomarkers that they looked at in this study. And in fact, they saw this anti-inflammatory association. And the last of these epidemiological studies is from the Framingham Offspring study. And here they looked at a broader range of biomarkers as well related to inflammation. There, I think something that's consistent between this and the last study was the interleukin-6 concentrations were decreased here with yogurt. Fibrin was also decreased. However, they didn't see a decrease or increase with other dairy products such as milk or cheese here. So when we put these three types of epidemiological studies together, we do not have evidence for a pro-inflammatory effect of dairy. So we can say dairy is not pro-inflammatory based on these epidemiological studies. There are some inverse associations with particular inflammatory biomarkers. Yogurt seems to be especially promising in that regard. So let's take a look at the evidence now from intervention studies and some of the systematic reviews that have been conducted. And in these types of intervention studies where they've given specific dairy products or mixed dairy type of diet, the consistent conclusion among these studies are that dairy is not pro-inflammatory, but has neutral to beneficial effects on particular biomarkers of inflammation. And you'll note here that these reviews may have focused on particular populations. So some focused on individuals who are obese or had metabolic abnormalities. So I want to take a closer look at some of these here. So this study by Bordoni and a group from Switzerland here took a look at 52 different intervention studies. And here they included studies on allergic individuals here. And this kind of explains their study results. So what they did was bin all of these inflammatory biomarkers and the dietary intervention there into an anti-inflammatory effect, a null effect, and a pro-inflammatory effects. And here they observed net anti-inflammatory or or neutral effects for low fat and high fat, both low fat and high fat dairy products. The pro-inflammatory types of biomarkers and responses, those came from the studies in allergic individuals there. So basically their anti-inflammatory results were mostly concentrated in subjects that either had a metabolic disorder. And another study, this is by Alvin and colleagues. They looked at 16 intervention studies from 2012 to 2018, and they did not see any pro-inflammatory effects when dairy was given to healthy or overweight and obese participants. And they said that the accumulation of these studies suggested that there were weak anti-inflammatory effects in healthy and some metabolically abnormal adults with long-term supplementation, but it was these kind of shorter studies were more inconclusive there. But one thing they said that they could conclude was that there was not a pro-inflammatory effect, rather the majority of these studies documented anti-inflammatory effects. And some other reviews I just want to point out here if you're interested in looking up also arrive at very similar conclusions to this study here. So I'd like to give you a closer look at some of the research that my group has been conducting on yogurt and inflammation and give you an idea about how we were interested in designing and some of the results that came out of our study here. We hypothesized that yogurt would modulate markers of gut barrier function and inflammation. And we decided to study this in obese and non-obese women. We know that obese women are at higher risk for chronic inflammation and then non-obese, which is why we want to separate this into these two groups. What the design of the study was such that over a period of 9 weeks, they consumed 12 ounces of yogurt per day. And at the beginning and at the end of the intervention study, they consumed a test meal, which allowed us to study that process of postprandial inflammation. And I'll talk about a little bit more about that in a minute. This design was parallel. So one group consumed a yogurt intervention, then another consumed a non-dairy control snack. And what we saw at the end of the study was modulation of a particular set of biomarkers that indicate improved ability of the body to respond to metabolic endotoxemia. And that's that low grade of that low grade exposure to endotoxins from the gut can induce the inflammatory process. Here we looked at soluble CD14. That was unchanged. That was the primary outcome of the study. When we take a look at a secondary biomarker for that, so we have LPS binding protein to soluble CD14 ratio. Yogurt was consistently lower in that relative to the group that consumed the control snack. That was true for obese and non-obese women in the study. Then when we looked at these endocab, which is the core antibodies toward endotoxin, depletion of that suggests increased exposure to LPS here. And so yogurt consumption, the yogurt consumers had higher levels of endocab than our participants that consumed the control snack. Interestingly, over the long term, and this is in fasting blood here, we saw no difference in IL-6 or CRP, some of the biomarkers that came out in the other studies, but we did see a reduction in TNF-alpha to soluble TNF receptor 2 levels here compared to the control snack. So here we see a modest impact on the TNF-alpha pathway. And I mentioned we did this part of the study where we induced postprandial inflammation, and the consumption of a high fat, high calorie meal delivers a large amount of fats and carbohydrates, which induce a postprandial inflammatory response. And what we did was pre-feed individuals before this high-fat, high-calorie meal with an 8-ounce serving of yogurt immediately before they consumed this large test meal. Here we see that yogurt blunted that postprandial inflammatory response. These are the data from obese individuals. We had similar responses in the non-obese individuals, and similarly, yogurt blunted that the biomarkers related to barrier dysfunction as well. So you can here you can see the obese response on the bottom here. Now, my group has been interested in trying to understand, you know, how yogurt might impact the intestinal barrier. Since we see it moving the needle on some of these biomarkers of barrier function. So we can study this in a preclinical cell-based assay model. What we do is grow up the intestinal cells here. And we see that these, here on the bottom, I have these three-dimensional pictures of the tight junctions. And so these green proteins are what hold the cells together and help form that network of barriers. So we have zonule occludens 1 on the left, and then occludin on the right. You can see that kind of that network there. But what happens is when we add some of these inflammatory cytokines, that reduces the barrier function. We can measure the electrical resistance across a Transwell insert here, and we can see that barrier function is reduced. When we add yogurt simultaneously with these inflammatory cocktails, you can see we prevent that loss of barrier function. So there's something acutely in the yogurt that is preventing that loss of barrier function there. And it turns out that that's related to the expression of these tight junction proteins. So up here we have staining, fluorescent staining for our control wells, and this is we're looking here at occludin, one of these tight junction proteins. That inflammatory cocktail will lower levels of occludin, but the yogurt will prevent that. And you can see a readout here of the data on the right there. So together, I just want to kind of re-emphasize here that in the when we look at the epidemiological, when we look at the data from intervention studies, dairy does not come out as pro-inflammatory. Rather, some studies are indicating specific anti-inflammatory effects, especially regarding fermented dairy such as yogurt. We are still working to understand the importance of food diet to immune health. And it's kind of necessary to factor in the totality of the diet there. And these helpful dietary patterns are still advised and include dairy here. And the other thing I want to point out is that our ability to kind of move the needle in these intervention studies results in modest changes. And we need to take that step to link that to chronic disease risk. So when we put this into, where are we in regards to consensus and guidelines in this regard? Here, I put this anti-inflammatory effects of yogurt consumption, our emerging evidence category. We have indications from these, but we need to work out the mechanism and understand more about what's going on there. But there is scientific agreement that there's not direct pro-inflammatory responses of dairy in healthy individuals at levels recommended in the dietary guidelines. And lastly, the dietary guidelines is recommending that dairy is a core element of a healthful diet here. So 3 cups of dairy for 1600 to 3200 kilocalories. And this is the type of pattern that's associated with reduction of chronic disease risk there. So with that, I'd like to thank the organizers and the many people who helped with our research and turn this over to Jim.
Thank you, Dr. Bowling. It's exciting to have this talk and being a part of really working on and grabbing the torch of taming the flame when discussion comes to dairy and inflammation. I have the fun part to discuss the practical applications that you can bring to your patients and clients to create slower inflammatory response in their lifestyle and their bodies and in their habits. My speaker disclosure, I currently serve as a National Dairy Council Ambassador for this presentation, including on area. And you got to hear a little bit about myself and Dr. Bowling and our bios, but I'm always intrigued to know who my audience is. I wish we were in person, but this is the next best thing. So just want you to take this poll, maybe about 10 seconds to figure out who is in the audience. Is it registered dietitians, MDs, PhDs, fitness professionals, or other? wow, 91% registered dietitian. These are my peeps here. We have some some PhDs, we have some fitness professionals and others. And, you know, when it comes to our field, we all have different educational levels as registered dietitians, as health professionals. The one thing I think we can attest to is we do follow the science and we are in a science-based field. One of our probably biggest whys in life is helping people. Where we differ in educational levels, we differ in philosophies, we differ in opinions, and that's okay. That difference is really what makes here and have a healthy debate. So my second question is, do you feel that foods cause inflammation when it comes to dairy? Yes, no, or I used to, but Dr. Bowling changed my mind. Okay, so we have about 70% no, about 14% yes, and about 16% but Dr. Bowling changed my mind. And, you know, that's okay. Difference of opinions in this field is important for us to, you know, really get down to the facts and debate these hot topics. So what are other people saying about dairy? In the polls, we see what health professionals, especially in the audience, are thinking and saying, but what are people saying? And first, I have to go to celebrity media spokespeople, because the celebrity spokespeople have the biggest voices, having millions of followers. And, you know, a lot of people are listening to some of the messages from many that are uneducated. So we have Vanna Hari. I'm sure many of you know the food babe. In 2005, she actually worked for the banking industry until she got involved in nutrition. She is one that isn't a registered dietitian, but does share a lot of misinformation out there. She once quoted that one of the ingredients in Subway bread is used to make yoga mats. And it caused a big stir, and a lot of people stopped eating not only Subway bread, but bread in general. She's also a comment about dairy chemical defoamers are added to yogurt. So when it comes to a lot of this fear-mongering and misinformation out there, we really have to cut her through the misinformation, sensationalized headlines as health professionals to be able to get the scientific knowledge out to our clients and our patients. How about Tom Brady? I mean, it's hard to knock Tom Brady, a 7-time Super Bowl champion. He was 42, still playing in the NFL. He has his T12 diet book, which says that he recommends no coffee, alcohol, caffeine, tomatoes, peppers, mushrooms, eggplants, fungus, dairy, gluten, corn, soy, added sugar, artificial sweeteners, MSG, and GMOs. I think he lost me at coffee. I don't think I'd be able to do that. But, you know, there's some healthy foods in here. And you have these athletes, these young athletes that are looking up to these NFL players or professional athletes and listening to their every word and following it. And they have growing bodies. So, you know, this type of messaging out in the public could be harmful when people are avoiding foods. And then we have Dr. Oz. So the British Medical Journal took and analyzed 40 of his shows with 479 health claims, and they found that 46% of the information that he shared was not accurate. The one slight he had against dairy was don't drink less than 2% milk because it contains more sugar than full fat. And I think the problem is when it comes to people speaking about foods is, you know, we're becoming a society that's almost anorexic. I don't know about many of your patients and clients, but they're afraid to eat. When you hear, don't drink this, don't eat that, they don't know what to do. And then we have Gwyneth Paltrow with her Goop Clean Beauty Cleanse. Have anybody tuned into her new station, her Goop station? But she bypasses cow's milk totally, and she tries the goat milk cleanse. So the theory behind this was that she consumes goat milk along with parasitic herbs for 8 days. And the theory is that the goat milk and the parasitic herbs are supposed to bait the parasites and get rid of them through the intestine. And this has been debunked by many, many scientists. So, you know, we have this information out there that millions of people are following. So we need to really raise our voice as health professionals to get the right information out there. Dairy in the media, when it comes to popular diets, we see many of them that are supporting dairy intake, many of them that do not include dairy intake. Then we have in our communities, and you know, we have all kinds of health professionals giving nutrition advice, from physicians to chiropractors. Your average physician has two classes of nutrition undergrad and spends an average of about 13 minutes with a patient. And they are definitely at a disadvantage because, you know, there's a lot of other things they have to speak on, let alone nutrition. So, you know, these are some, you know, professionals that are giving nutrition information. And, you know, some are highly educated, some are referring to nutritionists and dietitians for nutrition information, which is great. We have teachers, and you're probably wondering, why are teachers up here? They're not supposed to give nutrition information, but many of them are. I had a case study of a boy that came in the sixth grade, and he saw me. He was 68 pounds, and he was jaundiced and anorexic, and his parents brought him in, and I asked the parents, you know, where did he start in this journey? And they said he was an extreme OCD, and his third grade teacher told him, if you eat fat, you're going to get fat. And so he was scared. He did not want to get fat. So what happened was he ended up stop eating fat totally. And then that led to other macronutrients. So I met with them and talked to him about the importance of, he liked to build muscle. So I talked about the importance of not only fat, but protein and carbohydrates and your nutrients. To, you know, build strong bones and muscles. And he clinged on to that message, gained 40 pounds, is now thriving. But it was that message of that teacher. It can go a far way. So we have to be mindful of who's out there. And then we have fitness trainers. There's over 400,000 fitness trainers in our country. That they outnumber dietitians 4 to 1. And they're giving a lot of nutrition advice. Their touch points are way more than physicians, they're way more than dietitians. They see their clients 3 times a week. I wear that hat as an exercise physiologist. I feel that, you know, a lot of your highly certified personal trainers, whether it's ACSM, ACE, or NSCA, or your exercise science majors, really respect registered dietitians. They stay within their scope of practice. But in any field, you're going to have some that are giving ill will information and dangerous information to the public. And you probably see this if you're, you know, working with some in the field. And then we have different recommendations from our government, from schools. This is myplate.gov that recommends 3 to 4 servings of dairy a day. And then we have the U.S. Harvard School of Public Health, and that has their healthy eating plate that recommends 1 to 2 servings of dairy a day. So why is this relevant to you as a health professional? It's because our patients, our clients, that is why we're in the fields we are. They're confused about what to eat, what to drink. This is a poll from Food Insight. And that comes on us because it's really important that if we're the number one, resources for nutrition information and fitness information, you know, it's important for us not to pass the buck to other professionals that are unlicensed or that are giving false information and really stand by the science. So what are some science-based information and recommendations on inflammation? And, you know, in our practice, we speak about nutrition to our patients and clients, maybe 25%. And, you know, to you dietitians, this is a great opportunity to build your brand on lifestyle practices. When it comes down to inflammation, improving lifestyle practices can definitely have a positive effect on decreasing inflammation. If we look at the American Psychological Association, 50% of people are under severe stress. With COVID, I'm sure more now. According to the National Institute of Health, only 21% of people are physically active enough to see health benefits. And according to the Sleep Association, 40 million people are having a difficult time sleeping with chronic poor sleep. So when it comes to stress, which causes inflammation, what happens is there's an increase in chemicals that increase inflammation in our body. And over time, that could damage our bones, our joints, our ligaments, and cause abnormalities. And on the opposite side, research has shown by decreasing or by having stress management, such as doing yoga, recommending deep breathing or prayer or time management or, you know, meditation, we can help to decrease the inflammation in our body. So this is something that can be a really important, you know, avenue to talk to with our clients and not only, you know, combat emotional eating, but to help to decrease inflammation in the body. Next, we have exercise, and I definitely want to explain the difference between acute inflammation and long-term anti-inflammatory effects of exercise. So when we're lifting weights, for instance, and we have a high-intensity exercise, like Dr. Bowling said, there are some benefits to having inflammation, when you're breaking down those muscles and then you're eating quality foods to replenish those muscles and rebuild those muscles, you know, that is a different state of inflammation. When we do exercise, we do have a release of pro-inflammatory molecules, but then, you know, rebuilding them over time and having in the chronic exercise stage is where we want to get our clients to. What happens is the chronic exercise decreases inflammation in long term by reducing fat mass and by increasing the production of anti-inflammatory molecules. So I always talk about lifestyle, and we should be talking to a lot of our clients and patients about chronic exercise. It is so important we do this for a long period of time. And we look at cardiovascular training. What are the recommendations for those that are 18 to 65? It's recommended for aerobic activity to do a minimum of 30 minutes, 5 days per week, or vigorous intensity aerobic activity for a minimum of 20 minutes, 3 days a week. And we can't forget strength training. Every adult should perform activities that maintain or increase muscular strength and endurance for a minimum of 2 days a week. So this is something that's very important for us as registered dietitians to give this advice for physicians, for other professionals, and for fitness professionals. And then we have sleep. Sleep, you can see the benefits. Sleep has anti-inflammatory properties when prolactin is released, especially that's kind of the trigger in our REM sleep. But sleep is so vital. It's recommended that adults sleep on average about 7 to 9 hours a night. And this is something that's really important to talk to with our clients and patients. I always recommend the 10-3-2-1 rule. 10 hours before bed, no caffeine. 3 hours before bed, no big meals or exercise. 2 hours before bed, no work. And 1 hour before bed, shutting off those electronics. And I know that is very, very difficult in the day and age where we have our phone with us at all times. But this can create such a perfect lifestyle habits to get better sleep and help to decrease that inflammation in the body. So one of the myths out there is dairy products cause inflammation. And I think, you know, this is something that Dr. Bowling addressed, but I'll touch on it. The Journal of Nutrition came out with their validation of novel dietary and lifestyle inflammation scores. And of course, there's a lot of healthy foods on this list that can reduce inflammatory biomarkers, such as fruits and vegetables, which has flavonoids, antioxidants, polyphenols, which helps to create a positive factor on cellular cellular protection and decrease inflammation. We have our dairy, which can bind to bile acids and free fatty acids, which can help to decrease that oxidative damage to the gut and in turn decrease inflammation in the body. Fish and nuts have omega-3s, which have been shown to decrease those pro-inflammatory effects. And then we have poultry that has arginine and also omega-3s, which can help to lessen that vascular effect that's impacted and decrease inflammation. So, you know, by incorporating these foods into our client's lifestyle, we could, you know, help to set up that better stage when it comes to reducing inflammation. And the evidence is clear, dairy foods do not cause inflammation. Dr. Bowling spoke on this. There's some great resources on NDC's website, the Science of the Summary, and also some great recipes on usdairy.com. So I love to talk about practical applications. You know, this was a client that came in to us. His name was Victor, and he feared dairy caused inflammation. He had a lot of inflammation in his body when he first came in. He was over 300 pounds. So as a dietitian, as an exercise professional, what I did was I knew that the benefits of dairy could have on inflammation. So, you know, rather than doing an elimination diet on dairy, what I decided to do is I saw some major foods that he was eating that can cause inflammation, major lifestyle habits. We reduced his fried foods and his refined carbohydrates. He was very stressed. So we had him go to yoga 2 times a week. We had him strength train and cardiovascular train. He ended up, you know, sleeping 7-8 hours a night. And over 2 years, he lost 93 pounds. and gained 100 pounds on his bench press. And, you know, wouldn't you figure all his inflammation went away. And it was from those lifestyle habits and incorporating these healthy foods such as dairy, fruits, and vegetables in the diet. And it was an amazing, amazing feat to see someone not only lose weight, I think that's, you know, something that us as health professionals are going away from, but seeing all these other benefits in his life. So myth two. So if we talk about what are some other reasons why people avoid dairy? And I think, you know, a lot of people feel, well, they have lactose intolerance. They need to avoid lactose totally. And that's just not true. First, I want to go over what's the difference between a milk allergy and a lactose intolerance. Well, a milk allergy can affect most children from 0 to 3, but it's only 2.5% of the population, usually outgrown by 80% over age 16. A milk allergy is protein mediated, where lactose intolerance is gastrointestinal response to an adequate supply of lactose. Yes, for a milk allergy, if someone has it, if it's a child, toddler, there has to be an avoidance of dairy until it is outgrown. But when it comes to lactose intolerance, there's so many strategies that can be used. And I love this chart. You know, there's been research out there that one single dose of lactose of 12 grams can be tolerated with people that are lactose intolerance. But again, this is a personal, you know, just like not one size fits all for our clients, same thing, you know. So why not try small amounts of dairy in food or in smoothies, and, you know, with solid foods that can slow down the digestion, which means a better tolerance. There is obviously, we all know, lactose-free cow's milk. We have ultra-filtered milk, now ultra-filtered yogurts. Greek yogurt is strained and the process removes some of the lactose. We have a lot of our cheeses that are low in lactose, and a lot of clients, you know, don't understand that, so they avoid it totally. And then when in doubt, there's plant-based options, plant-based milks that have no lactose. So there's a lot of options for our patients and clients that are struggling with lactose intolerance. So another case study on this, I had a client that came in, she was 68 years old. She wanted to lose 70 pounds by her 70th birthday, and that was a feat. She was morbidly obese, but one of her issues coming in is she feared that milk bothered her stomach. So, you know, I started, you know, looking into her diet. That's the first thing I do. Let's see what is she eating that could be causing this. Well, she was in the process of losing weight, and she was taking in all these high protein, high fiber products that are on the market. And I calculated she was taking in 65 grams of fiber, and, you know, over 50 grams can cause some gastrointestinal distress in some people. So we lowered that to 25 grams, which is recommended amount for women. And voila, I mean, all of her stomach issues went away. That was the core of it. So what she thought was dairy products, which she heard, you know, that might bother your stomach, you know, we proved that there was other things in her diet. And she wasn't lactose intolerant, she got tested. And she did lose that 70 pounds. It took her 1.5 years. And you can see her strength went up. And it was a very exciting case study we had. So I think the problem is, I've been a dietitian for 20 years, and I can't even believe this slides up here. These are the most demonized foods in America today: complex carbohydrates, fruits, dairy, and meat. And, you know, I feel that, you know, we're having an anorexic society. I had a patient not too long ago. She went to a business breakfast, and I go, "What did you eat there?" And she goes, "I didn't eat anything." I go, "Why?" She said, "Well, there was bagels there, and I don't eat grains. There was fruit there, too much sugar, and of course, I don't consume dairy." So I said, "You eliminated three food groups." So, you know, we're losing a lot of nutrients, and I think that's the problem. When we eliminate a food such as dairy, there's a lot of benefit lost. You know, in serving of dairy, we have 13 vital nutrients. For those athletes out there, dairy has leucine, which is a branched chain amino acid. The recommendation is about 2.5 grams a day, and that flips that muscle building switch on. So you can see the amount of leucine in our foods. Also, in order to get the amount of calcium that's in three servings of milk, our clients have to eat 7 cups of kale. And is that reasonable? If so, okay. But, you know, can we hit those marks and get those nutrients in by, you know, switching to other foods? And then we can't forget, how about the fun? How about the culture with a lot of our foods? You know, enjoying the foods and, you know, finding ways to, you know, enjoy them and keep them in the American diet. I love this hashtag, have a plant with dairy. You know, everything is about inclusion now. Why can't we include, you know, plants with dairy? Many of you probably have watched the documentary Game Changers, and you know, no one can argue we need more plants in our diet, but why not have a win-win, provide the protein, provide the calcium, vitamin D, along with fruits and vegetables in order to help out to reduce those inflammation biomarkers. And then here is just a meal plan. Many of you work with meal plans and put them together, but you know, let's interject a lot of these foods that can not only decrease those inflammation biomarkers, but also provide all the nutrient density that we need in our diet. So some take-home messages: 3 servings of dairy a day, as Dr. Bowling has mentioned through the research. Especially yogurt may have that anti-inflammatory effect. Limit inflammatory foods and habits. You know, when it comes to our fried foods, our refined carbohydrates, our alcohol, when it comes to smoking and these lifestyle habits, we want to, you know, really help to change our clients' daily living to be able to, you know, improve this and improve their overall health. Don't forget improving lifestyle habits, that sleep, decreasing stress and exercise on a regular basis, and then including those anti-inflammatory foods we talked about. However, I think the big message is to enjoy our foods. You know, rather than deleting all these foods in our diet, to enjoy them, to be able to, you know, share the science. And I will definitely challenge all of you registered dietitians and trainers out there and physicians to fight the good fight. There's a lot of misinformation out there, and you know, we need to stand up behind science, and our message of truth will definitely prevail. Thank you.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much, Jim and Dr. Bowling, for this great overview of dairy and inflammation, as well as overarching lifestyle approaches to address inflammation. We have a lot of questions coming in the chat, but before we jump into the Q&A, I have just a few reminders to share. If you're looking for more information on dairy research, recipes, and resources, please visit usdairy.com, where you'll find our archived webinars that include more than 10 hours of continuing education. So you can check that out. And then if we move to the next slide, as we approach Hunger Awareness Month, Feeding America's nationwide awareness campaign designed to inspire the public to take action on the issue of hunger, we've recognized that hunger awareness and nutrition security is a priority topic for many of us. And we'd like to invite you to visit Feeding America's Hunger Action Toolkit linked here and tune into our archived webinar on the ethics of hunger with Clancy Harrison, the founder of the Food Dignity Movement. I think, again, this is a topic that is near and dear to all of us that work in nutrition and health and wellness. So look forward to really calling the attention to Hunger Awareness Month that it deserves. So with that, we'll go ahead and take some questions. And as I mentioned, it's a popular topic, Jim and Dr. Bowling. There's a lot of questions in the queue for you here. So I think we'll get to some of them, and then perhaps this gives us good information for some content on our website that we can address for folks as well. So let me scroll through some of these. Jim, first of all, there's a lot of requests. If you can repeat your 10-3-2, your guidance on, reducing, getting better sleep.
So 10 hours before bed, no caffeine. We have 3 hours before bed, no big meals. Having a small snack is a little bit different, but no big meals that's going to disrupt sleep by digesting, absorbing in the middle of the night. 3 hours before bed, no exercise. Our adrenaline hormones are up after exercise. It gives us energy, which are all good things, and increases our body temperature, but maybe not right before bed. 2 hours before bed, no work. And that's something I struggle with. So, and then 1 hour before bed, no screen time.
Fantastic. I know folks will appreciate that because that was a hot topic in the Q&A chat. And then another one for you, Jim, do you have any idea where the misinformation about dairy and inflammation has gained ground?
You know, I think looking at some of the heavy hitters in our celebrity media spokespeople, a lot of the nutritionists are out there that are, you know, behind maybe some of the plant-based movements, we're seeing it. And, you know, it's just going away from a lot of the research that we know that's been tried and true. I mean, dairy is one of the most researched foods. So, you know, it's really important to for us as health professionals to be able to deliver this misinformation. And then, you know, 38% of families listen to their friends and their neighbors. So, you know, it's just like, it goes around. Once this information starts going, gets picked up by the popular media on Facebook and Twitter, it starts igniting.
Yeah, thank you. And I think it's, you know, the beautiful thing about science and research, right? Because it is through work of Dr. Bowling and other researchers that help us bring the research to bear to kind of debunk some of these myths and misnomers. So Dr. Bowling, speaking about that, there's a lot of questions for you as well. One, did the EPI studies look at whole fat or non-fat dairy?
Yeah, good question. So in kind of the biggest of the of those three, they did bin the study results by high fat and low fat. And there they found both high fat and low fat were associated with the anti-inflammatory types of responses in those studies. So from the and also in the first epidemiological evidence, we considered they also considered both the high fat and the low fat dairy as part of that anti-inflammatory factors.
Great. And then there's also a lot of questions of people wanting to know what type of yogurt was used in these studies. Was it low fat, full fat, Greek, with or without added sugar? So I'll let you answer that. And then just so you know, there's some questions about kefir as well.
Great. Yeah, I think that's the interesting thing. And part of the challenge of running these intervention studies is, you know, what do you actually study? And so for the choice that we made for our study was to choose a commonly available commercial yogurt that was available to us and present in all pretty much all the grocery stores around us. And that was a sweetened yogurt, so it did have added sugar in it. So we were, you know, we wanted to choose, you know, kind of a yogurt that was more representative of what people were eating in the marketplace there. So, you know, we haven't gone so far as to compare an unsweetened versus a sweetened yogurt, but I would say, you know, this is what we used in our study was very conventional and available to consumers there.
Yeah. And I always, you know, when you dive into that research, I always found that fascinating that it was, you know, based on what people have available in the grocery store. And so it's not necessarily any special, you know, magical type of yogurt, but the type that many people have on their breakfast tables with the added sugar. So I think that is really provocative in terms of the power of what might be in the dairy food and the dairy matrix and the nutrients that it provides. One more for you, Dr. Bowling. I continue to hear that there is a link between dairy fat and inflammation, and be told there is general dietary recommendation to be dairy fat conscious. Do you have anything to say or to address this?
Yeah, so in the context of inflammation and what we know about saturated fat and inflammation, it is very difficult to kind of tease, you know, to separate these preclinical studies which occur with individual fatty acids versus supplementing a matrix like yogurt or any dairy product there. And I'd say that in the cell-based types of assays, it is possible to induce an inflammatory response with something like palmitic acid that activates that toll-like receptor 4 signaling. But that actually does not happen under all circumstances. So it's really kind of concentration and circumstance dependent there. And furthermore, when they do these types of assays with the dairy fat, it doesn't lead to that same type of inflammatory response there. So I would say that we don't have that same conclusion from literature that these dairy fats are, you know, specifically causing an inflammatory response. And in fact, there's been research looking at some of the polar lipids that are associated with the dairy fat fraction and you know, researchers are trying to understand exactly how delivering those decreases in inflammation there. So it's you know, difficult to take something out of context and study it, but I think the indication we have is that that's not the case for dairy.
Fantastic. Well, we are at time, but I want to thank Dr. Bowling, Jim White, as well as all the people that joined us on the Zoom today to discuss this really important topic. It is something that is really increasing in popularity and people are intrigued by it. But as we've talked about with Jim and Dr. Bowling, the science isn't quite there to support that myth. In fact, if anything, we're seeing really positive things about dairy when it comes to its impact on inflammation. And I think there's a lot of positive news that we can share with those that we work with as well.